So my talk is Medicine and Science and Research, Oh My. A bit of a tongue-in-cheek. And really, there's 3 points I'd like you to take home from this. The first point is nature can actually show us the way to design very effective and very safe products. Number two, if you're going to pursue this type of research, you have to take it to the edge of the envelope. And in this case, it's research in austere environments where you will go and you will test the concept, you will test the product under real-world conditions, and you're likely to fail. So the vast majority of my research, we've had a multitude of failures, but the third component is that's the way nature works. Nature is designed to let things fail, and finally something will float to the top that actually works and is fairly functional. So the first slide up here, this is actually a slide of human osteoarticular cartilage. You can see there's a very ingenious design to it. This has a horizontal and a vertical orientation of the bone spicules. The cartilage on top is very, very smooth. Now we're going to come back and look at some of the substances within this cartilage. Now this is the two simple molecules. There's a molecule of proteoglycan and one of collagen. Now the proteoglycan in this case is a sponge, has a very high avidity for water. The collagen then wraps that sponge up and keeps it from swelling, it keeps it from exploding. This is actually a miniature blow up of what your articular cartilage looks like. Very ingeniously designed, very, very strong. The half-life for articular cartilage is 114 years. Do you know what the oldest person that lives is? It's 114 years. So collagen is directly dependent on our health. We've not been able to replicate this structure in industry. So nature's come up with this. Nature can make this work, but we certainly have not been able to replicate this. Now, everyone likes Jello, all right? That construct that you just looked at, bone and cartilage, is essentially Jello. Now, you remember the commercial, watch it wiggle, see it jiggle. Cartilage itself would not be particularly strong, so it's the fiber orientation of those specific molecules that make it strong and functional. So if nature can do it, and we now have you've got TED Talks, we've got organic chemistry, we have cellular molecular biology. We may be able to unlock some of those simple secrets that nature has out there and improve form and function. This was a construct that I started mucking around with about 12 years ago. Now, this construct was designed to take into consideration anisotropic properties. So anisotropic properties are the ability of a joint to resist forces from different directions at different speeds at different times. And so we took the Jello construct and we strengthened it by orienting the fibers. And you can see this time I was trying to be clever and use little squares and rectangles and circles, and it did. It markedly strengthened the construct. And what this construct was supposed to do was to replace arthritic articular cartilage within a human being. We weren't even close. It did strengthen, don't get me wrong, but it was a failure. But it was a good failure because it pointed us more and more in the direction of where fiber orientation had to go. So I'm gonna switch gears a little bit and I'm gonna talk about research in the austere environment. I'm also gonna talk a little bit about Afghanistan. So 2001, we were attacked. We are in a protracted war with terrorism elements. They have a particular construct they use called the improvised explosive device. This thing is a high energy agent. When it goes off, it shatters bone, it shatters the joint, it rips muscle, it rips skin and nerves, and it also kicks up dirt. And within that dirt, it carries it into the wound, and you have bacteria and viruses and funguses that are now deposited into the wound. So in 2012, I went with a team to Afghanistan. We were going to look at, was it feasible to have our biologic technology utilized in the treatment of injured combatants? And so we went in and open-minded, and it makes sense that if you had something that you could squirt into a bone that would immediately fix it, it would decrease pain, it would decrease bleeding, but we had to come back. And after observing the wounds for 3 months, there was so much focal contamination, so much fungal contamination. They actually had a fungus that was eluding a heparin that would eat up the artery. So this stuff was it was nothing to play around with, and we had to make a decision that this was a failure, that we were not going to be able to utilize biologic fixation in order to treat the bones of the wounded. So I'm over there for 9 months. About 3 months into it, I've determined that our mission's a failure as far as that goes. But it gave me some time to look at some other things. And one of the things to look at were traditional surgical techniques in dealing with folks that are wounded in combat. Now, this is an external fixator. And you can see that there's some rods and there's some pins. And those all had to be flown in. Those rods are about $1,000 a piece. So there's about $5,000-$6,000 worth of hardware on this individual. All of it had to be flown in. It had to be sterilized. It takes a lot of logistical support to have the stuff in there. It takes surgeons and a clinical team with nurses and anesthesiologists to know how to use this stuff. So I was able to look at this, and strangely enough, those rods were about the same diameter of some of the stuff that we were using for another project. Now, this is the back table in a war zone, and you can see, and if any of you have been in an OR, you know it's a pretty busy place. So there's a tremendous amount of scissors and bowls and retractors and all sorts of gowns and dressings and things that have to be flown in to the austere environment in order to perform surgery. And it's not just on the wounded. There's other folks that would greatly benefit from the ability to have advanced surgical techniques within their community. So what if we've come up with an absorbable biologic, a polyurethane, so to speak, made out of the components of Jello? Calcium, phosphate, hyaluronic acid, all oriented very, very specifically. It doesn't polymerize until you mix it. And then we could actually generate a rod for a bone. So this thing would still work in a closed fracture. Well, I'm just saying we're going to not use it in military combat injuries. So for the elderly, this would be ideal technology. Perhaps for a pediatric patient when you're trying to operate and not involve the physis. And what if you could build molds that would further enhance your structural organization? So here's a little girl that was burned in an IED attack. And you can see they're putting a dressing on, and that dressing has got a very specific configuration. We can actually three-dimensionally print these dressings. I can three-dimensionally print it, put a soup in that would have antibiotics that would elute onto the injured site. But also, from our study of how skin works, I can put little micropores in it that would allow epithelium to migrate in, and this acts as a skin graft. So we're able to generate an artificial skin graft based on nature that helps the patient fight the infection and heal the wound. Now, this little girl's burns are treated. And this is not only are there terrorism attacks around the world, but a lot of kids will pull cooking oil over on them in an austere environment. And that's what happened to this little kid. At 18 months of age, she had pulled some cooking oil on her. And it contracted the joints. She's only like 7 years old, so she can't ride a bike, she can barely walk. And we're able to go back, and I do soft tissue releases, but to pin the feet, there are actually some biologic pins available. So I don't have to use metal in this child, I don't have to use plates. I'm able to use a biologic pin that would hold the joint stable for a period of 3 months, and then it would dissolve. And the beauty of this, it dissolves, blood makes it dissolve. Blood, interestingly enough, is 7% saline, the same as ocean water. And we'll come back to that in a minute. So I'm able to put the pins in, and the child is able to get her foot flat. We get her a bicycle, she rides around the camp. And so this is what can happen If you can bring in technology into an austere environment, perhaps a village, perhaps someplace around the world that doesn't have advanced surgical techniques. So a lot of the world, perhaps more than a billion, 2 billion people, do not have access to energy. So if we can utilize solar and wind power to power batteries and then work with three-dimensional printers based off of direct current, I can actually print, or my team can actually print, instruments and tools that would be used for this type of surgery. So this is the White Cell Project, and the White Cell Project is actually here in New Bedford. In 2013, we were able to secure funding, and this is sort of the third portion of the talk. Now, you saw when I went to Afghanistan, we were working in an austere environment, we were testing concepts, and we were testing product, and we had some failures. And so with this next portion, I need to replicate those conditions. Now, I don't have a lab here, so the easiest lab I could get was to bring in a research vessel. This is a Coast Guard designated research vessel, has solar power, it's got wind, it's got sails, very green. And my team is able to put 3D printers on board, and we're able to actually replicate items with this. This is the Phoenicia. She's 88 tons, 70 feet. You can see the sails, and it's got a wind turbine on back. So she started a expedition from Portland, Oregon last year, came 7,000 miles through the west coast of California, off the coast of Mexico, Central America. At each place, my team retrieved samples of seawater. And that seawater, we're looking at what particular microorganisms would work best at dissolving a biologic polyurethane. So there's a method to the madness. Because what's happened in our oceans is we have mountains of plastic debris. And that plastic's not going anyplace. It just circulates there. I think in the Pacific, they've got one like the size of the state of Texas, just plastic particles. And the technology that we're now developing, this is gelatin brand Jello. It goes into salt water, it gets sunlight on it, and poof, it disappears. It disappears into calcium and phosphate ions that your shellfish, that your clams, your oysters, those very things that we started the talk with, can utilize to make new shells, to make new backbone, okay? It buffers the water. And the nice thing is it disappears entirely. So it doesn't leave trace elements behind. So it's safe, it's effective. This stuff is actually very, very strong. This particular fish hook, I stole this from National Geographic, took a picture of it, and we fed the information into our printer, and we printed this fish hook. The fish hook was then tested. I can hold up a 200-pound person with this fish hook. We had a number of these, and we put these into dishes on the way around from Portland, and we watched the rapidity by which they dissolve. Now, that would be useful if you're working in maritime industry and you're trying to protect your fisheries, protect your water quality, because if a turtle swam into something like this, it's gonna dissolve. So, to give you an example, if I've got a fisherman out with a six-pack of beer, and he's got that plastic thing around the top, he takes it off and he throws it in the water, a fish or a turtle is going to swim into that. With this stuff, I can make it dissolve within about a week, okay? So this is sort of the final slide, and I've got three components to this slide, and I want to revisit what we initially started with. So what I'm holding up there is a absorbable polyurethane. This is basically gelatin brand Jello that has been structurally characterized to be strong, effective, beautiful, but also very safe. And I can make those rods that I use for external fixation. I can actually put this into somebody's arm, and it eventually breaks down into calcium and phosphate, which is what bone cells utilize to make more bone. So this is the future of medical technology, at least in the Western Hemisphere, and probably also in third world countries, because we'll be able to use this. We have to watch for the pure contamination, but structurally, this should really be a game changer as far as rotting of bones and even plating of bones. I could use this with face fractures, and you would never have to go back in and remove the plate. Now, that mold, you can see a mold on there with a bunch of little holes in it. So that little girl, the little burned girl, we came back, and I'm like, you know, we can do this. We can make a collagen dressing, and collagen is a potent mediator of platelet activity. It'll bring in healing cells, and we can engineer little holes in this so that the epithelium will migrate in and heal this. So we're already able to manufacture dressing based on a solar or wind turbine, and I can go to any place in the world and do this, all right? And thirdly, I've got a total joint there. I haven't forgot my original project. So my big interest is still in osteoarticular reconstruction, and hopefully we'll get to a point where we'll no longer have to do metal and plastic joints. What we'll be able to do is I'll be able to take a little bit of your cartilage and seed it into one of my matrices, and then we can take away that diseased portion of your bone. I hope you take those three messages home with you. Have a wonderful afternoon.